Barber. Amen, Brother Justin and Sister Dior and Brother Paul Baumeister's grandbaby. We're glad to have Elder Baumeister here today. Amen. Justin and Dior, stand up. You have little Samil back there. Samil, give them a big hand. Glad they're back visiting today. Brother Nolan Carpenter, all the way from Maryville, Tennessee, which is not far, well, it's basically a suburb of Knoxville. And his father pastors a great and beautiful and growing congregation there. His father is also the general superintendent of the Assembly of the Lord Jesus Christ, and doing an incredible work of global ministry, not only there in Tennessee area. Brother Nolan, come up here. We want you to testify right now. He's going to be here preaching. I want all of you young people fired up for Tuesday night.
Praise the Lord, everyone. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. I believe some people were set free this morning. I can't wait to see what God is going to do tonight. I'm so glad that He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord tonight.
I'm looking. We got another preacher's son here. They just love the Rock Church, I guess. We're glad to have brother Trent. Stand up, Brother Trent. We're glad you're here. Amen. He just had a burden for Sacramento. And that's a talented young man. I think he plays just about everything. And he's also a professional crop duster. And so y'all pray for Brother Trent. He flies at night dusting the crops, and he's a Holy Ghost daredevil. Amen. We're glad. Give Trent a big hand. We're glad he's here. Amen. Well, if you have your Bible, let's go. I'll let you be seated. This has been somewhat of a unique service. Guests, we are glad you're here. Rock Church, you're glad our guests are here today. Let's go in your Bible to Matthew chapter 5. I pray God touch my voice tonight. Since that bout with pneumonia earlier this year, it has been a struggle. So I request that you would say a prayer for me. Amen. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13. The Bible said, "Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt hath lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men." In other words, if salt is not salty, what purpose does it have? It has no purpose whatsoever, so you get rid of it. "Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Let your light so shine before men that they," everybody say "they,"
"Amen,"
"that they may see your good works, and they," when they see your good works, "they will glorify your Father which is in heaven." I want to preach a little bit tonight on this subject, gathered and scattered. Gathered and scattered. Amen. Everybody say, "Thank the Lord."
Thank the Lord.
My title tonight is based from my idea of what is taking place tonight and what God intended to take place tomorrow. On Sunday, we gather, and on Monday, we scattered. Would you say gathered?
Gathered.
And scattered.
And scattered.
Look to your neighbor and say, we are gathered. To be scattered. We are tomorrow, when the alarm goes off, we are scattered throughout the marketplace, through the school system, through the political system, through the legal system, through our community. We are scattered throughout our community as Jesus followers sent on a mission. I know that at 6 o'clock or 4:30 or 5:30 or 7 o'clock, whatever the time the alarm goes off at your house, I know that's probably not the first thing that comes to your mind. Probably the first thing that comes to mind is, I need a drink of water, and your wife says you need to brush your teeth. But I hope that in this message tonight, I could stir within you an awareness that sometime in your preparation, from alarm to clock in, that there would come again to your remembrance a divine calling upon your life individually and to all of us corporately. That on this Sunday night we have gathered, but tomorrow morning we are scattered to serve the kingdom. The marketplace, from a biblical standpoint, especially in the New Testament, is the spawning ground for the New Testament church and its ministry. I will say it clear tonight that we were made for the marketplace. Most church time is spent going over theology and doctrine and dogmas and holiness and separation and miracles and stories of Jesus. But can I stop in all of that tonight and give you what is in my spirit? And that is that the New Testament church, the Rock Church, the apostolic believer that sits in this room tonight, was made to be engaged in the marketplace of our community. If all we do is sit on Sunday night, Sunday morning, Tuesday night, Friday night youth service, waiting on the world to come to us, we will never accomplish God's will for Sacramento. This church belongs in the marketplace. This church, our nesting vision is helping people become. Look at your neighbor, say, we're about helping people become. In this church, we stress education. We stress business planting and business startups and promotion and development. I want to encourage every young person in this room to stay in school. You're living in a day, I know you don't have to have a college degree to get educated or to be successful. I understand that. But you set yourself up for a lot better opportunities the more you develop yourself. If you're not a college student, not everybody's made to do that, I understand. But you need to develop a skill, and you need to find out what you're good at, and you need to do it better than anybody else. You don't win in life by tearing other people down. You win in life by being your best and doing your best and doing it better than anybody else. I want to help you become. I want you to be the best student. I want you to be the best preacher. I want you to be the best musician. I want you to be the best worker. I want you to be the best manager. I want you to run the best business in town. Why? For the young, I didn't come to a business class. I know that. But I've come to preach to you tonight. This church was made for the marketplace. God wants every businessman and businesswoman in this church to be a light in the business community. He wants every student to be a light in the schoolhouse. He wants every teacher to be a light. He wants every preacher to be a light. Whether you're selling coffee or you're plumbing a job or whether you're building a house or developing a child, whatever you're doing, do it to the best as giving glory to God. Hallelujah. for what God is going to do in our life. We were made for the market. We were to spread God's influence in the marketplace. I want you tonight in the Holy Ghost to realize your position where God has you at this season. You may be in a temporary situation. You may be without work right now. You may be in a temporary job situation. You may be in a time of trial and testing. But you need to realize that your position is where God is working in your life. And if you're in a trying time right now, ask God, in this season, if this is a testing time, then what is it that you're trying to teach me? Because even in my worst situation I'm facing today, there is something to be learned and gained. You may be in an economic downturn right now because of your own actions. Maybe your spending habits. Maybe your family's habits. Maybe you never learned to budget. Maybe you cost it. But even in that, there is a sprig of hope in the stump of financial failure that you can look and say, I may be declaring bankruptcy right now, but I'm going to learn from this. Call of God on every individual life. Now, just for the man, I want all of those that feel called to be a full-time preacher to stand. You feel called, you're going to be behind the pulpit, okay? I mean, you're already called. If you're already called, I'm standing. Y'all stand with me. I hope y'all are up here on purpose. I feel like I'm in the Sanhedrin up here. But I want you to look around right now. This is not the majority of this room. Now, I want only those that are full-time, what we call full-time, that your income is derived of your preaching ministry. That's all I want standing. Everybody else sit down. Hey, Dad. This is a Holy Ghost TED talk tonight. The future of preaching ministry, for those of you that stood, the chances are not real big that your ministry will not be bivocational. The urbanization of the world is changing. And probably we haven't spent enough time talking about bivocational ministry. But I really believe that part of the future of growth of the apostolic movement globally, in fact, some of the greatest revivals I am seeing globally are happening with bivocational ministry. So I'm even preaching to all of you that stood, that feel like the hand of God is to have you behind a pulpit. I do not debate that tonight, but I would tell you plainly what I believe the future is holding with the global urbanization that is taking place. As we see the development of technology and cost going up and the volatility of our society and world, the need for men and women in the marketplace that understand their calling in Christ is even that much more important. I had you stand to show you that it was not the majority in this room that will be preaching behind a pulpit. And the only two people standing in full-time pulpit ministry were me and my father. But I have not always been deriving my income solely of the pulpit. There have been seasons of church planting where I was bivocational. And in fact, in a sense, there is no preacher that is not bivocational, because the day-to-day is business like any other business. It's all work. It's all skills. It's all economics. It's all finance. It's all people. It's all communication. It's the same thing. A very small portion of my ministry is behind the pulpit. So my message tonight to the Rock Church and to the ministry of this church, including myself, is we have got to understand that our calling is the marketplace. Our calling is that we were made to be dropped and scattered into the community as men and women on a mission. If your dreams are only about a Sunday school class, are only about a pulpit, are only about pulling a trailer and being an evangelist, you're missing it. There is a dimension of the Spirit that is calling us to take the kingdom and expand it in the marketplace. There's not a lot of preachers preaching this on Sunday night. We'd rather preach about the mighty God of Christ. We'd rather preach about Jesus' name baptism. And there's a place for that. And we're going to keep preaching. But I want you to understand something. There's an awakening. God wants to anoint men and women in this church with a divine call in your vocation that I believe is a supernatural dimension. God wants you to recognize your position. He wants you to recognize your role. He wants you to recognize your responsibility. As you, not just me, not just Bishop Young, not just these preachers, but you as an individual, as a representative of Jesus Christ in this community. Why do I feel the need to take a Sunday night and preach like this? According to the George Barna Report, I want everybody that's 19 to 29, if you're 19 to 29, would you stand up? A big portion of this church. Give this group a big hand right now. Keep standing. You that are standing, keep standing. George Barna Report recently came out. 84% of the group that is standing in Christianity cannot explain what the Bible has to do with their career. 84%. In American Christianity, your age group, 84% cannot figure out what in the world the Bible has to do with your career. You may be seated. I don't blame you, the millennial. I blame the pulpit. Because we have made it about clergy and laity. That the preachers and the ministers that sit on the platform or have the titles in the offices, they're the people that have an inroad to God, and that's, you know, that's church life. And then we've got just our life, and our life is made to support the ministry, and that's just run together, and that's an old ecumenical system that is so alien to the Word of God. I've come to shake every one of you that are 19 to 29 and tell you that God has a purpose with your calling, with your vocation, with your career, with your studies, with your marriage, with your relationship, with your finances. God wants to be front and center of your life the very same way He is with me. I am no more holy than you just because I'm a pastor. You're to be as holy as I am. I'm supposed to be as holy as you are. The only difference between me and you is our calling and our position in that kingdom. I'm not to lord over God's inheritance as some potentate on a throne and call myself pastor and rain down authority and judge you and rule. No, that's not the way it is. I am to lead according to the Word of God. I'm to lead you as sheep. I'm not a cattle driver. I don't have a whip in my hand whipping you into place. What I do is I read that book and I pray and I get out front and I start walking. And my sheep hear my voice, Jesus said. Everybody that hears and follows. That's my role. Your role is to find the will of God for your life. The will of God is for you to study like you've never studied, to work like you've never worked, to be blessed like you've never been blessed, to expand the kingdom of God in the marketplace. hand. We got men and women in this church that have given their life to careers. Jeff Hendricks, stand up. Worked for the railroad. How many years, Brother Hendricks?
40 years.
Never robbed his company. Never cheated on his clock-in card. They were disappointed when he retired. He was injured on the job, hit his head under one of those trains one of those days. I remember all that years ago. But he kept working. Did you ever work with pain, anybody?
Yes, sir.
Did you ever work with people that you didn't get along with so well?
Just about every day.
Just about every day? Did you ever cuss them out?
No, sir.
Did you ever punch one of them?
No, sir.
Did you ever let their attitude rob you of putting in a good day's work? You got a good job and you retired well, put children through college and law degrees and helped them in life, I'd say you've been a successful businessman. But another thing, there's one thing I knew about Jeff Hendricks. Jeff Hendricks never put his church life and his work life. He didn't have two different sets of clothes. He didn't have two different conversations. He didn't pick up an ungodly brogue on Monday and then drop it on Sunday. This man, I can do it because I know him well. And you know him too. This man is a true Christian. He's a light. He didn't take the light he got on Sunday night, put it under a bushel Monday through Friday. But he would gather to be scattered on Monday. Know some heroes, guys? Go rub shoulders with guys like that. They're not up there singing. They're not up there doing their deal. They're just steady faithful. And that's the way the kingdom expands. By men and women that live their faith out. Here's a theological term. They incarnate the word they received on Sunday. They flesh it out on Monday. The blessing of God. Understand something. If this city was dependent on Curtis Young and Myles Young, we're in trouble. The kingdom cannot be built on guys getting their check from the church office. Do I have a role? Yeah. Does Bishop have a role? Yeah. Does Pastor have a role? Yes. But this kingdom moves forward in expansion by anointed men and women who gather on Sunday to be filled with the presence of God and the word of God and the favor of God to empower them and equip them. And then they are scattered into the marketplace as a light, as a city set on a hill that cannot be hid. You ought to be different than everybody else. You ought to shine like nobody else. You ought to work harder than everybody else. You ought to be that blessed man or woman. Sadly, we have separated our profession from our confession. We've left church on Sunday and work on Monday when God never intended it to be that way. God intended your empowerment and equipment that you receive on Sunday and on Tuesday at the house of God to be the equipping that sends you out as His workforce. Tell you what we need, the church needs a theological training of its people for vocational life. You are not in full-time ministry. I hate that. We use it, but I hate it. As if to say that I'm in full-time ministry and you're not. As if the only time that you're in full-time ministry is when you're at church worshiping. Let me tell you something. These signs shall follow the bishop.
No.
These signs shall follow them that prophesy.
Come
These signs shall follow them that get a check from the church. No. These signs shall follow them that
believe.
How many believe? I think the problem is we haven't talked enough about believers and their empowerment and their equipping and their calling. When 84% haven't got a clue about the Word of God in their career, we've missed the mark. You on your job, you in your classroom, you in your community, you in your neighborhood, you on your vacation, you wherever you wind up, you get a delayed flight and you get a bad attitude and chew the people as if they had anything to do with it. And you lose your Holy Ghost over some mechanical part on a plane that you couldn't make a connection and get home in time for something. And I know you're upset. I've been there 1,000 times, it seems like. And we lose our faith. Our relationship with God for 5 minutes and we lose our brain and choose some little 25-year-old girl out that don't have a clue what's going on the plane. She just got a job to do to keep all the natives from getting crazy. And you lose your testimony. When could it be that God stopped everything for you to have to sit for 2 hours next to some other person who's losing their mind, who's trying to get back to a mother that's dying of cancer, and they're about distraught, and you've been up chewing out the counter, nobody's even, well, what would happen if you said, God, what are you doing right now?
Good.
What are you doing right now?
All right.
God, I don't know why I'm stuck here right now, but God, if you can use anything, use me. I'm not being serious. I really wonder if we got more focused on kingdom than comfort. We started looking at every setback as a setup. What if we started looking, God, you're in here somewhere. You're in here somewhere. Lead me, guide me. I'm challenging this church. You were made for the marketplace. It's time to prepare our people to think about Christianity and your work. No, I'm not here to talk about your private devotion. I'm here to talk about your public commitment. If you've been on your job 6 months and they don't know you're a Christian, you're failing in your responsibility. I had a friend that took a church somewhere between here and the Pacific Ocean. He took the church and been there about 3 months. He had an evangelist come in. It was one of those wild evangelists that just come in. You know, what kind of church? And they were shouting, running, and bucking, snorting, and everything else, and having, you know, that bad name. I mean, they're just having church. And he turned around and said, you made me wonder what kind of church you came into. You came into a Pentecostal church. And the new pastor said, he said, Myles, it blew my mind. He said, there was a guy that goes, this is a Pentecostal church? He said, I've been coming here for 5 years. I didn't know this was a Pentecostal church. In case you didn't know it, you're in a Pentecostal church. At least the first 3 rows over here. Church this is tonight. You may be seated. But if they don't know who you are, young ladies, if they don't know who you are at that high school, you're not doing your job. Oh, I wasn't supposed to do that. I was supposed to like pat you on the head and say, oh baby, it's gonna be alright. You just hang in there. No. I'm sick of that. That ain't working. That incognito Christianity, it ain't working.
That's right. That's right.
That smooth operator, it ain't working. Oh, it works. bold as a lion. Why don't you decide tonight, as of this night, I'm going to work full time for the kingdom. I may be painting houses, I may be hanging baseboards, I may be dropping rafters or whatever they do, I may be painting cars, I may be flipping burgers, I may be taking tests, but I'll tell you what I'm doing, I'm working for God, I'm working for the kingdom, I'm expanding this thing, I was called to do the work of God in the marketplace.
Amen.
Three missional images, I'm almost done. Salt, light, and a city. That is a description of the church in mission. We are to reveal God and we are to glorify God. We gather to glorify, but we gather to be equipped to go reveal Him. If we go all week without ever praying with anybody, without ever talking to anybody, without ever sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, we have wasted a week. I know there's season. I know you're sick. I know there's work. I understand all. There's going to be times. I understand that. You can't have a pulpit on every job and every day. You got to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. You can't climb up on the table at your boss's desk and say, in the name of Jesus, you're going to hell. You can't walk into the classroom and say, I've come to tell everybody in this class, including the teacher, you are lost and on your way to hell. That ain't the way Jesus did it. He went about doing good. He was there to help people. He was there to let His light and His love shine. This week, we have got to become active. I'm not talking about 30 days from now when you get together. I'm talking about this week. Not after ladies retreat when you get shuffle mode and come off the mountain ready to walk on water. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about tomorrow morning when your alarm goes up. It's time to say, all right, I'm on duty. I'm on duty. I'm scattering. I'm scattering. I gathered last night, but I'm scattering today. I'm going out. I was empowered. I was equipped. I was renewed. I was strengthened. I repented. I was refilled. I'm going out to let my light shine.
Amen.
A theology for a global missional church attends and defines the biblical narrative from the creation to the eschaton, or to the thing all wrapping up, the story of Jesus Christ and the good news that Jesus is there for everybody. That's what our theology should be about. Every sermon I preach, whether it's holiness, separation, revival, healing, miracles, signs and wonders, faith or encouragement or teaching like I'm doing tonight, it all should be about one thing, equipping the body of Christ to scatter on Monday, to go do the work of Jesus Christ. If you got junk in your life, get it out, because you got to serve. If you haven't been praying, start praying. You got to go to work. If you're not living for God, then start living for God, because you got to do the work. If we're going to fulfill the will of the Father, we got to be active. We got to participate in the mission. It frames our identity, it determines our purpose, it orders our mission, and it reveals our hope. Let me tell you what the church has to do. The church, I'm almost done. This church, the Rock Church, this place we gather. Everybody say we gather.
Yeah.
What is the Rock Church? The Rock Church is the social location of theology. That's what this building is. This is the social structure that is built. The physical edifice to house the social gathering of people around the study of God, theology. Where we come together, but you did not come to a lecture hall to just get info. This is the social location of theology for global missional community. Every single service is to be about intake to pour out. Everything you receive, you are blessed to be a blessing.
Amen. All right.
Remember, he said, the angel of the Lord came, spoke to the prophet. said, "Eat this scroll. Ingest it. Take it in. Get that word in you." And he said it was sweet to the lips, but bitter in the belly. Some of the most bitter people I've ever met in my life are people that just sit service after service after service after service, and all they do is ingest, 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 ingest. And they never get it on their lips again. This ingestion, oh, it tastes so good going in. But if you let it settle in you and you don't bring it out and speak it again, you'll get bitter. And you'll become a connoisseur of preaching and worship and music. And you'll begin to judge the praise team and judge the preacher and label, well, he's that and she's that. They're that. They're not, oh, it's not going to be good tonight because that team's singing. And that, oh, boy, it's going to be that young preacher. Oh, it's going to be that old guy. And, oh, you know, it's, that's not the tribe I'm in. Makes me want to puke. Every time that word is preached, and every time that song is sung, every time we socially get, this is a social construct. Be lying to you if I told you different. There's a lot of social dynamics here. We try to work through all that and get all that right. But the whole point of this social construct is so that we can all get together and receive to in turn give it out. How many love the good news of the gospel? Amen. See how smart the class is. How do you spell gospel? G, G what? G, O. Gospel ain't just coming together. Gospel's got go in it. We gather tonight to scatter tomorrow. We need a faith community doing theology together. We need to know that my brother and sister is working tomorrow. Have you ever had an employee, a fellow employee at your job that don't do their job? Y'all are laughing. Y'all must have a lot of them. I mean, you got two guys and y'all work for the landscape company and y'all both mow the yard. And you look over, and he's leaving like gaps in the yard, and you got to go back and fix it. That ain't no fun, is it? Are you on the team cleaning the kitchen, and they're not doing their job, and you're having? Does anybody enjoy that? No. Y'all lying if y'all say you do. Well, we need to feel the support of one another when we go to work tomorrow for the kingdom. I need to know that my fellow kingdom employees are representing the kingdom the way that we're called to represent the kingdom. I need to know that they're letting the light shine, because here's the problem, is if I'm at the job with somebody else in the kingdom and they're living a different life than we're called to live, and I'm trying to win them to Christ, but my fellow employee is doing other things while they know we go to the same kingdom. You see, you're working against me. When I'm at the campus and everybody knows we go to the Rock Church, and I'm trying to teach a Bible study and gather around the flag and pray, and I'm trying to lead people to Christ, while you're coming in trying to sleep with the people, I'm trying to win the Christ. Ooh. Now y'all know why I'm full time. You see, you're working against it. case you didn't know it, we're all in full-time ministry. One day we're all going to pay the price for our deeds, the Bible said. The missional effect of this social gathering gathered around the theology of the gospel is that it must first be believed, then it must be obeyed, then it must be preached. See, what's preached has to be embraced. And then that embracing is not to clutch and hold ourselves in some elite holier than thou. Look, I thank thee, God, that I'm not like that heathen publican. No, they missed it. All of this teaching, all of this gathering, is to be believed, obeyed, and preached. That's why we must be fully grounded in the Word of God. You okay? Say, man, I like that hooping you was doing this morning a lot better than this. This is what helps us on Monday.
All right, good.
You see, all of us are in ministry. Look to your neighbor and say, you're in full-time ministry. So when you're gossiping about your brother or sister, you're tearing down ministry. Touch not mine anointed. Do my prophets no harm. So when ministry tears down ministry, that's not ministry. That's terrorism. When you're getting together with other saints and you're talking about other saints, when you're getting together with ministers talking about other ministers, that's not ministry. That's evil speaking. And you're damaging the body. And God forbid that you ever tear down the people of God to the unbeliever. Paul said, you shouldn't even take your court case. You shouldn't even take your brother or sister to court. Why? You don't do that. Why? Because you're supposed to be a city set on a hill. I feel conviction. What's that Old Testament scripture, Dad? He said, tell it not in Gath. There was some stuff that happened to the people of God. He said, no. Don't tell it in Gath. Why? Lest the adversary can see something going on and get an advantage of the people of God. You know what we need? We need a baptism of purity of our mouth. I just felt that. That wasn't in my notes, but I'm about sick of gossip. Sick of people with a bad attitude that are spreading their bad attitude to other people that aren't even interested.
Come on, good.
I'm sick of hearing about what young people did. I'm sick of hearing about what other people did. Why don't you talk to God about what you did? As if, well, you know what their kids did. Yeah, well, your kids did it too. Well, you don't know what he did. Yeah, but I can tell you about a whole lot of stuff. Well, I'm here, so I'm not sick of hearing about what I'm doing wrong, too. Well, I wasn't supposed to say that. Father, forgive me. Welfare, Hail Mary, full of grace, applesauce, come on, best. But you know what? I've noticed. Even good people are not good all the time, and even bad people are not bad all the time. So you got some dingbats that can do some good every once in a while, and you got some good people that can act like a knucklehead. I understand that. But I tell you what would help all of us. Let's help everybody, me included. What would happen if we just quit talking about people? I mean, I know we're not running the aisles, but let's just think about it. Let that sink in a minute. What if we didn't gossip? What if we didn't talk about everything they're doing wrong or did wrong? What if we just gave it to God and the people that are supposed to deal with it? I'm not talking about hiding sin. But you know what? I have watched situations that weren't very positive get blown into a civil war when it could have been handled in about a 30-minute conversation.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And an accountability program and some parents that had sense working through the issue.
Uh-huh.
Boy, all the young people, 21 and under, plug your ears. Parents, I was just kidding. Parents, there's going to be teenagers that mess up. Y'all didn't hear that. There's going to be somebody on this road. I'm not even looking who. There's going to be somebody on these two roads. Or those two. Bring the music and let it play. I'm going to prophesy. Someone is going to mess up. I feel it. There's going to be a whole nother hyena set. Spent 2 hours in his bedroom weeping and crying the last 3 nights, feeling like a loser, and don't know all the hell that kid's been through, and don't know all the junk they've wrestled through, and you're over there going, my God, look at that hypocrite. You need to shut your mouth and quit judging people and let them find an altar and pour themselves out and let God work on them. God, remove gossip from our mouth. Remove our desire to tell it and be the first to post it. Why don't we just do the kingdom work and take the gospel, get full of power, get full of anointing, and live for God?
All right. Amen.
Hey, you're going to get in trouble. Preaching like that's going to cause these young people to mess up.
Good preaching.
I guess they never messed up before I preached that.
Yeah.
You may be seated. It's time to understand we're supposed to be in the marketplace. We're to come get rid of what needs to be out. Be empowered by the Spirit by what needs to be put in so that we can serve our community. Gospel of Jesus Christ. There is no, can I say this? Let me, you're mature, you can grab this. There is no theology without mission. Sorry. For all the eggheads at the seminaries. One of my biggest frustrations in my doctoral studies was having egghead professors trying to teach me about the kingdom that had never done one thing except sit in a college classroom, get a degree, and then go teach. And I'm listening to them rattle off a bunch of stuff they got in, and I'm going, have you ever done anything? I had one woman, oh Lord. I had one more professor. If I call the name of the well-known televangelist, one of the big ones, songwriter, incredible. I mean, incredible. What all that is. He and I probably don't agree on probably 5 out of 10 things. But this lady, our first introduction to class, she started by calling the name of this big time ministry that she had worked in. And she commenced for the next 30 minutes to tell everything that was wrong with that ministry. And she went down, and in the process, she said, I worked on that staff for 20-something years. And I was thinking, she started telling stories about meetings she had with people on the staff over that 20 years. And it wasn't sin. It wasn't some immorality. She was talking about how their leadership ability and how they were rude and how. And I'm thinking, if that's really what you want to share with us? For 20 years, you earned a paycheck from them, and now you're going to trash them? And I mean, I don't even know the man. I am so sick of cynicism. I am so sick of people that don't see the blessing of God in their life.
Come on, all right?
If you could go with me for one day to some of the places we minister, people that have dirt floors with no toilets, with no running water, basically tin and cardboard and plywood for a house, and they come out, and it blows my mind. Little girls in Africa, little girls in Central America, in Asia, I watch them come out of dirt floors with no bathrooms, no running water, and they come out in their little spotless white dresses with little flowers in their hair, with a smile on their face, and I ask my wife, I get dirty with carpet. How are they living in a dirt floor and their skirt looks like it just came off the rack? And they got a smile on their face. And I'm pastoring people that are griping about everything when they got a job and they got an air-conditioned house and they got carpet and they got friends and they got a church and they got a youth group and all they want to do is yeah, yeah. Hey, come on. We got to get in the marketplace. Get the bushel off the light and let this light shine. You're equipped to go. What's God doing in your life, musicians? Come on. I'm done. I know this isn't typical Sunday night, but we have gathered to scatter. If we embraced our personal divine call and we recognized the temptations that come our way as the opposing forces to our kingdom business. Stand with me, I'm done. We're going to gather around the front in just a moment, but before we do, if you were in, how many present or past military people, any of the armed forces, hold your hand up. Give them a big hand. All the folks that are ready. If any one of you that just raised your hand were in the field of battle and you were met with the enemy trying to stop you from performing your mission, you would view them as a combatant. And you would take action, you're trained to take action to move through and past to accomplish your mission. All of you that, how many business owners out there? Let me see your hand. Business owners, oh yeah. If you woke up tomorrow morning and someone was outside protesting your business, you would see that as direct opposition to your business. And you would take actions to get them removed from the property, right? were running your business, how many employees had a couple weeks in? Okay. And if in your job, let's say you're in, Brother Emery, you're one of those tech guys. You run systems, you figure out problems and bugs and all that stuff in there. One of those smart guys. I don't know how your brain fits in that little skull of yours. But if you're working on security with that company on the internet, and you detected something in there that wasn't right, you'd begin to shut doors, lock doors, passageways on the computer through technology. You'd be figuring out, okay, that's, we got a weakness there, or we got something we got to repair here. You'd figure that out, wouldn't you?
Before we scatter, I want you to gather with me.